it up for them. Thank you, guys. Like we just sung, Christ be magnified. One of the cool things that happens in our ministry is as we follow the call to magnify Christ in our hearts and in our lives, that typically means that also then God sometimes sends people from our place to make sure that Christ is magnified in other places. And you're probably either cringing because I made that connection, but I think it actually is a meaningful connection that that is a part of what we do, is that we send people out so that Christ would be magnified in places that he has not yet been magnified in. And so there's two people that we're going to be praying for right now. I'll invite them up here in a second, but Todd and Cindy Christensen, they're sitting in the back there. You guys just want to wave your hands for a second. Here, you can clap for them. We can clap for Todd and Cindy. So some of you guys, students, probably more leaders, know who Todd and Cindy are. They've been serving, I think, cumulatively now for almost both you guys together, almost 10 years within high school ministry in life groups. And in this past year, they've been working behind the scenes with Connor on a lot of the discipleship curriculum that we are working on, that some of you guys are a part of, and that over the next couple of years that you guys are going to be blessed by. They've been working hard with Connor the past, 9, 10 months working on all of that, coming up with some curriculum that's really helpful. And so God is doing something in their life. They've had a desire for a while to be a part of a church that's getting planted, and so you guys are going to be going out to Ann Arbor, Michigan, to go and be a part of a core team that is planting Tree Line Church in Ann Arbor, Michigan. And so if you guys know anything about Ann Arbor, is that correct? Am I saying that right? Is it Tree Line Church? Okay. And also, that area is probably about as secular as it is here in our area, and so probably they're probably going to be the only people on their core team who are like, we know exactly what this is like, because there's a lot of people on their team that are coming from the Midwest who are from typically like more churched backgrounds. And so we're going to invite them up here. And if there's any leaders in the room, so John and Hannah and Andrea, if you guys can come up, Patrick as well, and if any of you students, Josh, and anyone else, you guys want to come up, we're just going to lay hands on them and pray for them and send them out. If you're a student who's been blessed by their ministry as well, feel free to come up. And so we'll try to make this not awkward by laying hands on you, or we can. And so what we want you to do as well, if you can just extend your hands out to them. And here's what we're going to pray over them. We're going to pray Philippians chapter 1, verses 3 through 5, where it says, I thank my God in all remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you all, making my prayer with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. And so, Father, we thank you so much for Todd and Cindy. Father, we thank you that for their partnership in the gospel these past 10, almost 5, 6, 7 years, Father, that they have blessed us with a commitment to the gospel of Jesus Christ. In everything that they've done, Father, they've been loving, they've been caring, and most importantly, they've been committed to making Jesus clearly known to the students and to the leaders who have been in our ministry. Father, they've blessed our students by being life group leaders. Father, they've blessed our leaders by mentoring them and caring for them. And so, Father, we give thanks to you for them. They have been such a blessing to us. And so, Father, as they've been a blessing to us, we are excited that they get to go and be a blessing to this church in Michigan. Father, we pray that you would send lost people their ways, Father, so that they might hear the hope of Jesus from Todd and Cindy. Father, we pray that as Todd and Cindy care for the leaders and the church leaders there, Father, that they would be as blessed as we have been by their ministry. And so, Father, we send them out with joy. We're going to miss them, Father, but we know that you have such a great plan ahead of them, Father. We just pray for gospel fruit in their ministry going forward, Father, that from them, Father, as we're even going to talk about today in the sermon, Father, that it would be this image of the vine and the branches, and that they would be a branch that bears good fruit, Father, and that they would glorify you in doing that, and so prove to be your disciples. So, Father, we pray over them. We send them out, Father. Would you continue to do your work in and through them? We pray all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. All right, let's give it up for Todd and Cindy, guys. If you see them while they're outside, give them a high five, or if you don't know them, just be like, you're great, because they really, really are, I really mean it in that there's a lot of stuff that they've worked on that we were actually joking about, that that you guys probably, you won't see in a formal setting. Like, it's not something that's going to be up on front of the stage, but it is stuff that is targeted at the heart of caring for you guys and helping you guys to get a clearer picture of what the gospel is and how the gospel of Jesus can truly change us and transform us and make us new. They've blessed us with that ministry and with caring for us in that way. And so I think it's fitting in a way that we wrap up a series on change, your guys' last. And this, and they said, this is like, this is the last service we're going to. You're the last one. You're the only one we're going to on this Sunday. And so we are grateful that you guys decided to be with us for this last moment. So let's open up our Bibles right now to John chapter 15. John chapter 15. If you don't know where John is the fourth kind of book in the New Testament. So Old Testament, New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, right there near the end of the book of John, in John 15. This is a passage where Jesus is sharing with his disciples right before he's about to be betrayed in the Garden of Gethsemane and then head on his way to the cross. And he gives them this really powerful image of how we are to understand what change looks like and how we are to be connected to him. And this kind of lands us right at the end of this series that we've been walking through the past couple of weeks called How People Change. And what we've been exploring in this series is really trying to walk through how do we actually change in our hearts and our lives. And we've been unpacking this definition. It's a little bit long and clunky, but it contains everything that I wanted to be in there, and I think it helps us to stay faithful to the scriptures, and it's simply this. Change is a lifelong process that God personally works in us and with us by his Spirit to form us into the likeness of Jesus for his glory and our joy. And so this whole process of change, maybe you guys have heard the word sanctification before. Have any of you guys heard that word? Or maybe we say that word to you in life groups and you're like, I have no idea what that means. When we're talking about sanctification, we're talking about change. It's this process, this lifelong process of the course of our lives where if we've placed faith in Jesus, the Holy Spirit is living inside of us and he is working this out in us so that, once again, by the power, the resurrection power of the Holy Spirit, that God would change us, form our habits and our loves and our desires and everything that we do, that over the course of our lives that we would look increasingly like Jesus, meaning that we would act like him and love like him and walk like him in and among our friends and our family and our coworkers one day who do not know Jesus, that they might get an image of what the living God is actually like through us, which is just a wild and marvelous thing to consider, that we were at one point rebels, sinners against God's cause, or more like rebels without a cause, and now we get to be a part of God's family and we get to be a part of what he is doing. So that's where we are right now. And so the past couple of weeks, obviously, we had Will and Aiden preach, which was great. We can give it up. I know Aiden's here, so we can give it up for Aiden. It's a big task to open up the Bible in front of your friends and your peers and to share with them. But kind of the last 2 weeks, here's what we've covered. Will focused and honed in on how change can, the way that change happens is through the power of the gospel. That it's through the fact that Jesus went to the cross and died for our sins, took the punishment that we deserved on the cross, and then put an end to sin and death by dying and resurrecting on the third day, the gospel. Through the gospel, we now have the ability and the power to change. The power to change is not within ourselves. It's not through self-actualization or just white-knuckling our way into holiness. It's only through the power of Jesus and Jesus working in us. And when Jesus left, what you'll see if you go on and you read John 16 is that Jesus says, it's good that I go because when I leave, I'm gonna leave with you the Holy Spirit so that he can be with you always. And that's why it's then through the Spirit that we're able to change. So we talked about the gospel, and then Aiden made it really practical, and we see this biblically prescribed way, which is a really fancy way of saying this is how the Bible tells us to do it, of how we are to then kind of work through change. And it's through Ephesians 4, 22 through 24, where he talks about putting off and putting on. I think one of the analogies that Aiden brought up was that it's a little bit like when you're digging a hole in the sand at the beach. Like if you just dig out like sand in the hole and don't do anything, it'll just fill back up again. But putting off and putting on is like digging a hole in the sand and then filling it with something new. And that's what we see that the Bible tells us to do, that it's not just enough to just say, no, I'm not going to sin, but it's saying no and then saying yes to, I'm going to walk in obedience and follow Jesus. And that can look like a variety of habits, whether it's reading the Bible or prayer or going to some other kind of activity that's going to help us to glorify God. And so we see that this is modeled even in Jesus' own life. So in Matthew 4, we see that Jesus, he's in the wilderness. He's tempted by Satan. And what does he do in order to fight temptation? He runs to the Word. He reminds himself of what God's Word says, and he prays. And we see the same thing in Luke 22 when he's tempted in the garden to say, like, do I really have to go through with this? And what does he do? He reminds himself of God's Word, and he prays, and then he goes to the cross. And so that's where we get all of that from. And so here on the last kind of day of this sermon, I want to remind you guys of some things that we said at the beginning of this series. A couple of things that I said right at the beginning is that simply that change is difficult. If you spent any amount of time trying to work on some undesirable habit or something that you have in your life, it's difficult. I was just joking with Connor the other day. This is not in my notes, so this is for free. He was driving in my car with me, and he's like, why do you have have you guys ever seen those hand strengthener things? Yes. And he's like, why do you have this in your car? And I was like, I was trying to break a habit with it. And he's like, what habit were you trying to break? And I would have this habit. I can't believe I'm about to confess this on stage. I'm such an idiot. I would have a problem with picking my nose while driving. And I didn't like it that I did that. And so I was like, oh my gosh, I've got to find something. My wife's like, I'm so ashamed right now. And so you're welcome. This is the personal part of being a pastor. And so I bought this thing so I'd have something to do with my hand while I was driving. But even when I did that, like, it's still difficult to break a habit. Like, it's still, you all make as if you have less, like, bad habits than that. Like, you, I'm just the one being honest here, okay? you're welcome. But change is difficult. Change is hard. But also, it's not always linear, right? Like, there's moments where we succeed and there's moments when we fail. Like, and I think one of the things I said in the very beginning, the very first sermon, now you're like, how many times did he touch his nose? Stop it. Stop it. You're better than this. just kidding. Oh, man. I think one of the things I said at the very beginning of the series as well is that often change feels like one step forward and two steps back. And it's frustrating because it's like, man, like, I'm supposed to be growing and becoming more like Jesus, but I feel like I fail and I fall on my face more often than not. And what that does, it humbles us, but it also reminds us that, man, like, change is a struggle. And so the question that I want us to answer today is essentially, what do I do when I'm struggling to change? What do I do when I'm struggling to change? When it feels tough, when I just feel like when it feels like eight steps back and one step forward, like, what do I do? Like, please help me. Like, what do I do when I'm struggling to change? And what I want to bring us back to here is just a couple of basics. And so this sermon is probably going to be very unmarvelous or like amazing, because I just want to bring us back to, like, when someone comes to me and they're saying, I'm struggling, or when I'm struggling, these are the things that I go back to myself, and I say, these are the things I have to remind myself of. There's no silver bullets, and what I mean by that, there's no magical cures or remedies to change. A lot of it is depending on the Holy Spirit and depending on Jesus, and a lot of it is just doing the hard work of getting into our hearts and realizing what's wrong with us, being honest about that, running to Jesus, bringing other people into our lives, and then slowly walking that process of change. It just simply takes time. So here's kind of the main idea and the basics that I want to draw us to today. Here's the main idea. Change happens when we are rooted in God. Change happens when we are rooted in God. And so we're going to use this image that Jesus gives us from John 15, to kind of unpack some of this, that change happens when we are rooted in God. And there's going to be a couple moments that we come back to this and understand what this means and unpack this together. So you guys got that down. Let's go to basic number one. Here's the one of the basic truths that I come back to and that I want to encourage and kind of give to you to come back to when you're saying, man, I'm struggling to change. I feel like I keep on losing. What's the next thing? Like, okay, how do I hit the reset button? How do I get back into obeying God and doing the right thing and honoring him? I think the first basic is this. Apart from Jesus, change can't happen. Apart from Jesus, change can't happen. This is a fundamental truth that we need to come back to when we're struggling to change and realize, okay, apart from Jesus, change can't happen. So look with me in the first five verses of John 15. They're going to be here up on the screens, as well as you might have them on your phone or in your Bible. And this is what Jesus says to his disciples. He says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. And every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. Already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. And these next two verses are really what we're going to focus in on here. He says, abide in me, and I in you. So abide is this kind of this old word for like dwell, rest in, make your home in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches, and whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. So Jesus gives us this image of this vine. And he says, I am the vine. He is the thing that is living, that is growing. And we are the branches. We are grafted in. We are connected to this source of life. That's the image that he's giving here, that we pull the power to change and the ability to live a flourishing life from Jesus, who is alive. And we see in verse 4, he says, abide in me and I in you. And he goes on to say, as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. We don't have to do much theological, exegetical jumping here to simply come to the very clear realization that what Jesus is saying is that we can't grow or change unless we're with Jesus. That's what the text is very, very clearly saying. It even goes on to say it even further in verse 5. It says, I am the vine, you are the branches. In case we were confused, Jesus is the vine and you are the branches. We are not the source where life and change comes from. Jesus is. And this statement that Jesus makes, this I am the vine statement, is this big, it's called the Greek phrase is ego eimi. And what Jesus is doing here is that when he's in the same way that in the beginning of Exodus, where he says to Moses at the burning bush, I am who I am, it's the same construct. Jesus is claiming that he is God here. He's saying, I am, ego eimi, I am. It's the I am who I am. It is the God of all ages who is speaking here. And he's saying, this is who I am, and this is who I am to you, that I am the vine, I am the one who gives you life, and you are connected to me through faith. So then goes on to say in verse 5, whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit, for apart from me, you can do nothing. Apart from Jesus, we can do nothing. And this leads us to this kind of this reality that I think oftentimes why we will struggle when we're trying to change is because, and why we often can't change is because we are typically trying to do it on our own. Like God has prescribed the way that we are to change. He said, this is how this needs to happen. It happens through reliance and faith in God. And we say, yeah, well, that's cool, but I want to do it my own way. We all kind of do that in one way, shape, or form. And we try to do it in our own way. But he says here, we can't do anything apart from him. We need to be connected to the vine in order for us to change. And so here's another question that I want us to kind of ask coming out of this text, because he's talking a lot about bearing fruit. And when we're talking about bearing fruit, we're also talking about what it means when we are connected to Jesus, when we've placed faith in Jesus, that there is then something that changes in us, and then there's this fruit that is born in our life. So you guys know that like a healthy tree, if you have a healthy apple tree in your backyard, what does it do? It bears fruit. Like it makes apples, right? It doesn't make like porcupines or something weird, right? Like it makes actual and real fruit. Like that's the purpose and the point of the tree. If you have an apple tree in your garden that doesn't bear fruit, like that isn't bearing fruit, that means that something's probably wrong with it, or it's either like not an apple tree. One of the two. Okay, but that's the purpose of the tree. The purpose of the tree is to actually bear fruit. And so for us as Christians, as we, if we've placed faith in Jesus, the goal as a believer in Jesus is that we would bear fruit in our lives. Now, we don't bear apples because that'd be weird, but we bear a different kind of fruit. Like Galatians 5:22 talks about that we, and 23 that talks about we bear the fruit of the Spirit. And I wrote them down, Bennett, so that you won't come back and correct me. but the fruit of the Spirit is this. The fruit of the Spirit is love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and faithfulness and gentleness and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. And so this is the kind of fruit that we are to bear if we are connected to Jesus. And so the question that we also need to ask in this is, how can we tell if we are actually bearing fruit? How can we tell that we're actually abiding in Jesus? And if we are abiding in Jesus and bearing fruit, then the fruit is going to look like those things that we just talked about. And so, once again, apart from Jesus, we cannot change. And so, as we're abiding in Jesus, here's some things that I think that we need to be looking for and examining in our own lives. So if we're struggling to change, I think we need to ask ourselves, okay, where is the fruit? Where is the fruit in my life? And it's gonna lead you one of two ways. Either it's going to lead you to a place where you say, okay, I'm looking at my life, and none of what was just described in Galatians 5:22 and 23 describes me. Okay, so if that's you, which we've all been there at some point, then we need to ask ourselves, we need to be really honest and say, okay, if that is the case, then it probably means that I am not actually following Jesus. And if you're at that spot, then the next step's actually really simple. If you can realize that and see that and know that, then the next step is to say, okay, I want to change. And that means you need to place faith in Jesus. And say, okay, well, I need to, once again, go to the gospel, and rehearse the fact that Jesus has died for my sins. And through his resurrection, now I can have new hope and new life. And I want to place faith in him and what he has done. And from that, this is kind of the next thing that I want to encourage you to do, is then I would encourage you to get people around you who are going to help you to grow in your faith. It could very well also be that maybe there's no fruit in your life because you're like, man, like I don't know how to grow. Can someone help me? And that, in a way, is what we're here to do as well, that we want to help you to walk through your life, being able to know how to follow Jesus. And a lot of times that happens by someone discipling you. That's what Todd and Cindy and many of our other leaders have been to many of the students in here, and many of the students who've graduated out of here. They've been people who've said, okay, we'll walk through what it looks like to be a follower of Jesus with you. And so there's no like shame in saying, hey, I need help in that. Can you help me to follow Jesus? And that's a part of what we are to do as well. Another way that we can kind of examine and look and see if there's fruit in our lives is to, and this is kind of a weird phrase that I'm using, but it's to examine our loves. And what I mean by that is simply look at your life, look at the amount of hours that you spend in a week, and just ask yourself the question, like, what do you spend the most time doing? What do you spend the most time doing? And I would say that if you're showing up on church on Sunday and Wednesday, and between those two hours of somewhat Christian activity, there is no iteration of you seeking out Jesus, then I think that you have to be really honest about that. And consider the question, okay, if that's my version of Christianity, which I would venture to say is actually not faithfully following Jesus, then once again, we come back to this thing of, okay, it sounds like something needs to change. And once again, there has to be that moment of honesty of, okay, something needs to change my life, and then placing faith in Jesus. And so really, in any way, shape, or form, like the response here is to come back to this place of, okay, is there fruit in my life? If there is, okay, how can I get someone else to help me to continue to grow? But also, if there's not fruit in my life, then I need to be honest with that and run to Jesus so that I might find the person who can help me to change. And so, once again, if you're here and you're kind of still figuring this Jesus thing out, or if you're like, man, like I can look at my life and honestly say I don't see a lot of fruit in my life, your response to today's sermon, your next step of obedience towards Jesus from today is to place faith in Jesus. And that's something that, kind of in a way, I want to even stop now and just say, like, and say that this is important enough that we're even going to pause for a moment and kind of land on this and say, we want you to realize that that's the greatest application that you can have coming out of the sermon, is to place faith in Jesus. And so we'll have a time at the end here where we want to invite you to do that. We want to invite to have that conversation with you and to help you to walk through what it looks like to trust in Jesus. And we'll come back to that here at the end. But also there might be some of you here that you're saying, okay, maybe there is fruit in my life. I really am following Jesus, but I'm still struggling to change. What am I supposed to do? And so the second basic I want to draw your attention to, which is already on the screen here, is that bearing fruit is proof of our abiding in God. Bearing fruit is proof of our abiding in God. And so this kind of comes right out of John 15, verses 6 through 8, which are going to be in the screens here, and you can read in your Bible. It says this: if anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers, and the branches are gathered, thrown into the fire and burned. But if you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be given for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples. And so here's what bearing fruit in our lives is, and here's what it's not. Bearing fruit in our lives, in our hearts, so growing in love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, growing in those things is evidence that we're placing faith and relying on God to change us. It's not the thing that saves us. It's the evidence of what God has already done in us. And often we get those two things mixed up, that we say, okay, well, if I can just white knuckle myself into being the self-controlled person, then people will think, oh, like, I follow Jesus and I'm godly. And that's a really, really exhausting way to live. And I know that some of you are living that way, because I used to live that way before I was saved. I thought if I could just fool everyone into thinking that I'm a godly person by playing the part and being an actor in front of them while I was here on Wednesdays and Sundays, then maybe then I'll believe I'm a Christian too. And it's this endless cycle of kind of just stumbling on your face over and over and over again. But rather, what Jesus is saying here is that bearing fruit is the evidence of something that's actually changed in our hearts and in our minds, that we're actually placing faith in Jesus. And then down the road, what comes out of that is change. That slowly over time, we become more loving, joyful, and patient and kind and good and faithful and gentle and self-controlled in all these different areas of our lives. And so in a way then, fruit in our lives, it's evidence of what we truly believe. It's evidence of what we truly believe and of what we are putting into practice in our lives. In a way, fruit is the evidence of your habits. Like we talked about that for a couple of weeks right before this sermon series, that we are, in a way, we are the accumulation of our habits, of these things that we continually do and that we practice doing. And fruit is the thing that we cannot escape. It simply just comes out of us. That in a situation that is frustrating, we instantly get angry, or we get mad, or we get anxious. And it might not necessarily be a sin to initially feel those things, but it's what we do with it then. If we then just live in the anger and we full send it, or we live in the anxiety and we full send it, and we don't even think about what God has said or what he's doing, or how he's called us to not be anxious, but in everything with prayer and supplication, to let our requests be made known to him, to be angry, but sin not. To not be prideful. But then we also see that there's moments where situations come up in our lives, and then the fruit that does come out is patience and gentleness and kindness. And we see, oh, this is the evidence of what God is doing in me. I'm not taking any of the credit for it. God is the one who's working me and changing something in my heart. And because he's doing that, now I'm bearing fruit in my life. And so here's the question that I would come to with you. If you came to me and you said, Henty, I am a follower of Jesus. There is some fruit in my life, but I'm struggling in this one particular area. What am I supposed to do? There's a couple of questions that I would initially ask you. And they're kind of under this umbrella of this other question, which is, how is your abiding going? Simply meaning, Are you in the Word? Are you praying? Are you in community? And hear me very clearly. When I say those, when I ask those questions, I'm not saying, are you doing more? I'm asking, who are you with? Are you just sitting in your own mind? Are you running to the things of the world to try and change you? Or have you been around Jesus? Once again, in the whole habit series, we aimed, especially the part about reading the Bible, we aimed it around two ideas, love and knowing. Friends, we're not going to change and not going to be able to fight against the things in the world if we're just trying to do it by white-knuckling it into existence. The things that change us, the reason why you do what you do and you have the habits that you have is because of what you love. The reason why, friends, we'll be able to change and not sin and be self-controlled is because the promise of Jesus is better and because we love him more than what sin can give us. That's what changes us, is love for him. And so we read God's word, not just so we can check a box and get our life group leader off our back, like, finally, dude, stop texting me about reading my Bible. We read our Bibles because God has revealed himself to us in his word so that we would know his character. We would know the sacrifice that he made, not so he could just guilt trip us into placing faith in him, but so that we would see that from the very beginning of time till the very end of time, God is saying, I love you and I purchased you and I bought you and I made you and I want to be in a relationship with you. That's the goal. That's why God has given to us his word. And that in that, like, if you love something, if you love someone, you don't have this detached, weird relationship with them. No, you spend every waking moment trying to figure out who is this person and what do they do and how do they act and how do I know everything about them? And the more that we do that, then we unpack the treasure trove that is the wonder and the mystery and the beauty and the awe of God, that we see that he is transcendent above all things, but yet that we also see that God then sends his son Jesus to be just like us, so that he would know what it's like to be tempted, that he would know what it's like to suffer and to be in pain and to suffer anguish. I mean, think about it. That Jesus, before he raises Lazarus, I mean, he's sitting there and it says, like, this, it's the best verse to memorize in the Bible. Jesus wept. This is not like I'll pity cry because, you know, I want the nice little Christian people to think that I'm relatable. He's genuinely grieved over the fact that his friend is dead. That's the God of the universe who is inviting us into relationship with him. He's not some detached, uninterested person. And if you're spending time with him, with Jesus, spending time in prayer with him and then in community with other people who are reminding you of who this God is and of what he's done to be a part of your life, to save you, to work in you. That leads us to some kind of change in our hearts and in our lives. Once again, this is not a silver bullet. Like, we're, even if we do spend every day in the Word having this meaningful time with the Lord, like, we're still going to sin. We're still going to mess it up. But what even happens in that is that when we sin, we're quick to repent because we're like, man, like, that was stupid. Why did I do that? Like, I don't want the sin. I want to go back to Jesus. I want to be back with Jesus. I don't want the promise of sin anymore. And so there's kind of this inescapable truth about change. And it's this, and you're like, dude, like, you're just a pastor and you just, your application is always like, read the Bible and pray. Yep, I got a two-shooter and that's it. Like, it's read the Bible and pray. But at the end of the day, that's it. If you want to change, or if you want to take some incremental steps in growing and changing, change is hinged. It's connected, tethered to God's word. We cannot change unless we are in the word. We just simply can't. I mean, look at what this verse is saying. If you abide in me, my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it'll be done for you. And that's not like some blank check about like, cool, I can just get whatever I want. It's about when we are abiding in him, resting in him, dwelling in him, living in him, and letting his word refresh and renew and restore our hearts and minds. He gives us new desires and new loves. And if you read this verse and you say, cool, I get whatever I want, then you've read it incorrectly and your heart has not been changed. When we read this verse and what it says to us is that when we are abiding in Jesus, the thing that we want most is Jesus himself. We want more of him in our lives because we know, and we'll get to this at the end of this thing. Jesus is writing this and saying these things to his disciples for our joy, that our joy would be full. That Jesus, he's not some cosmic killjoy who's just come to take away all the fun things that we want to do in life, but he's come to open our hearts and our minds and our very bodily existence to experience what true and real joy actually is, and that is to be known by God, to be fully known and fully loved by the creator of the entire universe, and to one day look forward to the day when we get to be how Adam and Eve were at the very, very beginning, where they walked in the garden side by side with God. And that is then eventually what's going to happen at the end, where Jesus comes to restore all things and we get to walk side by side with God as it was in the garden, where Eden is restored and we look forward to that day. That's what God's heart is towards us. And so, to kind of bring this all back to this point, this basic idea, is that if we're struggling to change, the place that I would encourage you to do is to ask you, friend, are you in the Word? Are you praying? Are you in a community of people who are encouraging you to be in the Word and to apply it to your life? And part of this is God's gift to, part of his gift to us is the gift of each other. That often we get to a place in our faith, in our life, that we're like, man, like, I don't know where to go next. Like, I don't know what the next step of growth is. And so you have life group leaders, you have other leaders that are in your life, especially your parents, who are called by God to disciple you, to raise you up in the faith that you would know the way to go. And so then we get to be discipled, and then we get to help disciple other people as well. So God gifts us to each other. But maybe you're like, man, like, I've got some really serious issues that I don't want to just talk with anyone about. And God's word even makes provision for that. And here at Canyon Hills, we call that biblical counseling, where it's really just a little bit more of like formalized discipleship, where someone pair up with someone else and we say, great, we're going to focus in on this one issue in your life. And we're going to help you walk through this issue. We're going to stick in this with you until we see change. But all of it falls under this umbrella of discipleship that God has gifted us with each other, that we might be able to grow and bearing fruit, so that as we bear fruit, we'd be able to be, as verse 8 says, that by this my Father is glorified. What's the this? That you would bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples. So that God would be glorified in us and how he's changed us. And so the third basic that I want us to kind of look at here, and we'll begin to wrap this up, is that change happens when we long to abide in Jesus. And what I really want us to get at here is we're talking about the heart. That change is all about changing the desires of our heart, changing what we love, changing our affections. For a lack of a better description, I remember a friend of mine who's a professor at Biola, he described it this way, that let our hearts, this is kind of a gross analogy, our hearts are like tongues, and they have taste buds, and we're just like wiggling our way through the world, tasting all these different things. John's like, what are you doing, dude? And there's certain sins that we brush up against, and we're like, ooh, I like this, and then we go to a different thing, we like that. And what God is doing when he comes into our life is that he's changing our very taste buds so that the things that we would love and that we would enjoy would change and be different. So you're like, okay, I get it, because I deal with that every single day, but it's still a gross analogy, I know. But that's what God is doing. He's changing the very desires, the very taste buds of our hearts. And I would say, and I'm saying here, change happens when we long to abide in Jesus, when our desire, our affection is, I have a free moment. I want to steal away for a moment so I can be with Jesus. It means that waking up early in the morning, yeah, like it's still tough because sleep is great, but Jesus is greater. And so I'm going to get up and I'm going to spend time with him in the word every single day so that I can be with him, so that I can spend time with him, so that I can grow to become more and more like him. And once again, this doesn't mean that we become perfect in all of our attempts to obey Jesus, but it means that over time that we grow increasingly in our love for him. That the priority of Jesus grows and grows in our life, that we center our lives around how can I be with Jesus? How can I share Jesus with people? And you might say, well, Henty, that sounds like all-encompassing, and it's because it is. But friend, I promise you that you'll have more joy in your life by focusing in on Jesus than trying to find pleasure in the other things of this world, because the other things of this world will always overpromise and underdeliver. They'll promise you the world and they'll take your soul. But there's no better deal than what Jesus gives. Jesus says, I'll take your sin, I'll take your punishment, and I'll give you my grace. I'll give you new life. I'll give you new desires. No one else does that. No one else offers that. You can't find a better deal. And so change happens when we long to abide in Jesus. John 15, 9 through 11 says, it says, the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love, and if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. And these things I've spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be filled, may be full. So the call, once again, it's like the third time in this passage, Jesus is saying, abide in me. Abide in me. And the best way that we can then abide in God and in his word is to do what his word commands, what his word is saying. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. The evidence of what we love is going to be then in what we do. Once again, we're the accumulation of our habits, of these things that we do. And when we follow God's commandments, it's once again, it's showing that something has changed in our hearts and that we love God more than anything else in our lives. And so here's what I'm going to do. I've got like another 6 slides, and I know you guys are like, it's 1:33, you need to let us out of here, because Aiden let us out super early last week. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to leave an image here on the screens for you guys to see that I think I've just called like the six roads that combine the direction of change. And so I'll go through all these real fast, and I'm just going to leave it up here, and you can write down the notes if you want to. But here's what I want to do. In this, you can think about this, maybe discuss it with your groups later on, with a friend. I think these are a couple of things that when we're looking for, okay, how do I start a new way of change in my life? I think these are the things that come together. That we have to be honest about the fact that we have sinned against God and admit that. We need then to be humble, to not be prideful in our sin, but to humble ourselves before God and say, God, I've sinned against you. That then turns into faith. It says, believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and you will be saved. So then we place faith in what Jesus has done for us on the cross to save us from our sins. In that is humility. And as we do that, then we are able to find, once again, the power and the ability to change that Jesus gives. I think the next step to bringing Jesus into our lives is to bringing other people into our lives, to be a part of a community of people who are going to help us to change, which then also is evidence that the Holy Spirit is working in us. So in Acts 1, it talks about how the Holy Spirit came down in power. And so the Holy Spirit comes down in power and changes our hearts. And this then leads to new loves in our lives. And all of these things converge on the kind of like the overpass of repentance, that we then bear fruit in keeping with repentance, and it leads to change and obedience in our lives, which at the end of time leads to the final union with Christ, that we will be united in him. And the two guardrails that protect us on this is one, Philippians 1:6, which says essentially that, I'm trying to remember it, I'm totally blanking on it, that he will bring to completion the work that he's begun in us. So God's promise is that he will complete this work of change that he has started in us. And in Philippians 3:12 through 16 is the other guardrail in which Paul says, and this is where we'll end today. He said, not that I've already obtained this or I'm already perfect, but I press on to make it my own because Jesus Christ has made me his own. Brothers, I do not consider that I've made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. And let those of you who are mature think this way. And if anything you think otherwise, God will reveal that also to you. Only let us hold true to what we have attained. And so what we have attained through faith in Jesus is the ability to change. And so the rest of our lives is this forgetting what lies ahead and straining on forward to following Jesus even when it's hard. And so God supplies the power and the ability to change, and we get to experience that and get to change in our own hearts and lives. And this is the process that we kind of get to walk through our entire lives. So with that, I'm going to leave you guys right there. Let me just pray for you real fast, and then we'll head out here today. Father in heaven, we thank you for the beauty of your word. Father, I just pray that you would stir up in this room right now a desire, Father, a renewed desire to be with you, to be with you in and through your word, that we might know more of you, that we would love you greater than we do right now. Father, so that we would experience the joy of being in relationship with you and the joy of being changed and getting to reflect you in all that we do. Father, would you simply just help us to change? Help us to become greater reflections of your glory and of your grace. We pray all this in Christ's name.